Hey, welcome to another edition of Living Your Hope Live. I'm Joe Olsson. I've been thinking a lot this week about the church community, and I want to share some thoughts with you about that tonight. Before we get to that, I want you to check out this video. We've been working on this band called The Bus Stop. It's an outreach band. And just a disclaimer, we made this video before social distancing kicked in. But hey, enjoy this, and I'll see you in a few minutes. Well, that was The Bus Stop, a good group of friends and a great group of musicians, a lot of fun to play with. Looking forward to taking that out on the road and doing some outreach with it real soon. And well, here we go. I want to welcome everyone from Living Hope Family Church here in Tucson and everyone from Praise Chapel from Rancho.
Train leaving on track 5 for Anaheim. Azusa, and Coop Kamunga. Step right up.
Hey, you're welcome, Rancho. Highest praise to be in a Looney Tunes cartoon. Well, I want to go ahead and talk about community today. And, you know, the church very much is a community. It was designed by God to be just that. We need community. Somebody said one can acquire everything in solitude except for character. We only get character by being around other people and having that iron sharpening iron experience and having those corners rubbed off our lives. And we really do need one another to fully realize what God is trying to accomplish in our own individual lives. And I've been thinking about this, and I think this time of being physically apart gives us kind of a rare opportunity to step back and clearly see what kind of community we're building, and to actually take the time to make sure that what we're creating rightly represents the community of the King. One of the hardest things to do is to take an honest look at ourselves sometimes and be willing to admit, hey, we need to change here in certain ways. And I, like a lot of other people, I think there's probably a real wave of evangelism that's going to begin to happen in this hour and in this time. And I want to make sure that our community is in the right place to be ready for that and to see God do that in our midst. And so I want to talk to you about maybe a socially distant or a closed community. And I want to talk to you about an open community. I want to talk to you about what the differences are. And maybe in this, we'll see ourselves and perhaps God will be able to help us. So let's start by talking about what is or what makes a closed community or a, you know, what makes our community out of touch with the world around us and what makes it so that they cannot relate to us. And I think it begins when we make those things that are comfortable and familiar to us, and we take those things and we make them holy. In other words, we seek to protect and we seek to preserve and to keep that which is familiar to us. And we invite people to come and join our world. And, you know, if we're not careful, we end up creating an atmosphere in a world that the lost, they have no place in it. They'll only foul it up if they come in, right? I was reading about a man who went to D.L. Moody, and he testified that he had lived on the Mount of Transfiguration for 5 years. And Moody turned to him and said, "How many souls did you lead to Christ last year?" And the man said, "Well, I don't know that I've led any." And Moody said to him, "Well, we don't want that kind of mountaintop experience. When a man gets up so high that he cannot reach down and save poor sinners, there's something wrong." So being a closed community is not being prejudiced against certain people. It's requiring that all people adapt to us. And if you think about it, Christianity really is kind of its own subculture, right? The Bible says, "Hey, we are strangers and pilgrims." And in other words, we're our own type. You know, we have our own language, right? Praise Hallelujah. We use words that no one else uses. We have our own music. We have our own fashion. We have our own morals. We have our own values. We have our own traditions. And we are a subculture. And we need to understand that. We need to see that and admit it. And here's a real news flash for you. The world doesn't really think we're all that cool. And I'm okay with that, and you're okay with that. But if we're trying to reach the world, we have to stop and really see, how does the world see us?
Well, isn't that special?
Now, you know, we can say, you know, fine, I don't care how the world thinks about me. You can talk about me any way you please. I'll talk about you down on my knees. And when they get saved, they're going to appreciate who we are. Well, you can take that kind of a stance all you want, but that is the kind of thinking that closes the community. It's that kind of thinking that, you know, spends its time trying to get the world, hey, come on over to us. And, you know, the world's looking at us going, you know, I hate to tell you this, but you're kind of weird. See, the problem is we get to the point where we mistakenly feel that if someone doesn't join our subculture, that therefore they can't join the kingdom of heaven. And so we're always trying to get them to come on over to where we are. Hey, it's true physically, right? Come to my church. Come. Hey, where did you invite people to during this whole pandemic? Hey, come to my, wait, you can't come to my church. In other words, we can only invite them into the kingdom. It's true of our traditions. We invite them into our traditions. We invite them into our theology. We invite them into our morals. We invite them into our values. We invite them and say, come just as you are to the Lord. And then they come in and get saved, and we're like, ha, got you. Now, let's get you into church Sunday morning, a men's group Sunday night. We'll join the choir. Let's cut that hair, cover those tattoos. You are now mid-trib pre-wrath. Say it, mid-trib pre-wrath. You no longer smoke, chew, or run with girls who do. And congratulations, you are now a Republican. So in contrast, let's look at what defines an open community. And I think first and foremost is the fact that we go to them. We're not waiting or just trying to tempt them to come to us. I read about Christ. He met unbelievers where they were. According to one count, the Gospels record 132 contacts that Jesus had with people. 6 were in the temple, 4 were in the synagogues, and 122 were out with the people in the mainstream of life. Now, I can tell you for myself that not being able to meet in the church, in that building for the last 6 weeks, has really kind of helped to reshape my thinking about what I'm inviting people into. You know, an open community is more interested in discovering what is familiar and valued to the people we're contacting than it is in trying to clone them into something that we are personally comfortable with. An open community is constantly aware of the culture around them and looking for ways to adapt so that they can understand us and we can understand them. And, you know, I'm not talking about putting on a false face or throwing out righteousness or any of that, but it would sure help if we stopped shaking our heads at anyone who's more than 10 years younger than us. See, an open community basically takes themselves out of the way of people trying to get to God. We're not adding our own list of addendums to the list of salvation requirements. With God, it's simple. Believe, confess, get wet, and follow. The Bible never says that they have to join our subculture or start talking like us or acting like us or doing all these things. An open community seeks to give to people and not to take things away from people. In other words, we want to give them hope. We want to give them truth. We want to give them life, not just go in and try to take away their habits and put our values on them. Do you know that we can trust God to do those things? We can simply give them hope and life and truth and trust God to work on their habits, to work on their values, and then cause them to walk in a way that's pleasing to Him. We don't have to do that part of the job. The struggle to have an open community is nothing new. You can look at the community that Jesus surrounded Himself with during His ministry. Jesus' community was the disciples, right? They were a closed community that He constantly was struggling to open up. The disciples saw themselves as being very exclusive. Look at Mark chapter 9, verses 38 through 40. It says this, John said to Jesus, "Teacher, we saw someone using your name to cast out demons, but we told him to stop because he wasn't in our group." "Don't stop him," Jesus said. "No one who performs a miracle in my name will soon be able to speak evil of me. Anyone who is not against us is for us." See, Jesus put value on those who are outside the group. And, you know, the disciples' attitude was that the world should come to them. The world should accommodate them. Look at Luke chapter 9, verse 51 through 56. As the time drew near for him to ascend to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. He sent messengers ahead to a Samaritan village to prepare for his arrival. But the people of the village did not welcome Jesus because he was on his way to Jerusalem. When James and John saw this, they said to Jesus, "Lord, should we call down fire from heaven and burn them up?" But Jesus turned and rebuked them and said, so they went on to another village. Jesus says, look, you guys are messed up. You completely don't get it. Jesus left eternity. He left what was familiar. He left what was comfortable. He put on flesh and lived where we live. He didn't demand that we do all the accommodating. He came and accommodated us. The disciples didn't take time for those who couldn't add to what they were doing. Look at Matthew chapter 19, verses 13 through 15. It says this, Then little children were brought to him that he might put his hands on them and pray. But the disciples rebuked them. But Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." And he laid his hands on them and departed from there. Jesus is telling the disciples, look, you guys don't even recognize the community of God. He says, for of such is the kingdom of heaven. The disciples struggled with being a closed community even after Jesus was gone. After Judas died and Jesus was risen, the disciples decided, hey, we need a number 12. Our group has 12, always has, always will. This is what we're comfortable with. And so listen to this list of qualifications they made. Acts chapter 1, verses 21 through 26 say this. Judas must now be replaced. The replacement must come from the company of men who stayed together with us from the time Jesus was baptized by John up to the day of his ascension, designated along with us as a witness to his resurrection. They nominated two, Joseph Barsabbas, nicknamed Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed, "You, O God, know every one of us inside and out. Make plain which of these two men you choose to take the place in this ministry and leadership that Judas threw away in order to go his own way." They then drew straws. Matthias won and was counted in with the 11 apostles. So think about their requirements. First, they said, well, we need somebody that we are familiar with, somebody we're comfortable with. And that was the job description. Now, I know they prayed there and they said, God, show us which of these guys it's going to be. But I don't personally think they got an answer, because I don't think God said, well, thou shalt draw some straws and that'll decide it. You know, this just kind of shows their thinking. They were stuck. We just got to have 12. We got to get 12 in here. This is what we're comfortable with. And, you know, here's Jesus. He told them, you're going to go out and preach the gospel to the whole world. Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and you shall be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Not only did they not get out of Jerusalem until a little bit of well-placed persecution motivated them, but they only preached to the Jews. So we see there was a major problem with the community of the disciples. They were a closed community, and despite having a close-up mentorship with the perfect discipler, Jesus himself, they were stuck in a wrong way of thinking, and they couldn't even see it themselves. So let's finish up. I don't want to go long, but I want to talk to you about community builders, because God always has a plan, and in this case, he had a plan. His plan was a guy named Paul. When the disciples decided it was time to replace Judas, they never would have considered a guy named Saul. Saul was this hardcore Pharisee, and he had made it his personal quest to destroy the followers of Jesus. And I remember a pastor, a friend of mine, once said, he said, you know, the disciples chose Matthias as the 12th apostle, but God chose Saul of Tarsus. Listen to this, Acts chapter 9, verses 15 through 16. He is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before the Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel. For I will show him how many things he must suffer for my name's sake. And then look at Acts chapter 9, verse 26. And when Saul had come to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him and did not believe he was a disciple. So, you know, Paul shows up to Jerusalem and they're like, nope. I am not comfortable and I am not familiar with you. No way. So Saul, or Paul, he was this outside the box wild card. He was certainly not with the disciples from day one. He crossed every line that the others were afraid to cross. He had no problem preaching to the Gentiles. He had no fear of publicly confronting Peter and the others when they tried to keep the community of the church closed to Gentiles. And Paul built church communities with groups of women. He went to places that no one else was going. This was a man who had a sense of an open community. So let's take all this talk of community and bring it down to us as individuals. In other words, we all have our sphere of influence. We all have maybe 8 to 15 people that we can affect, that we can influence, that maybe no one else can. And I have to ask myself the question, how is the community of Joe Olsson? Is it an open community or is it a closed community? Another way of asking is, does my heart and my life make it more difficult for others to come to Jesus, or am I making the way easy for them? See, the Apostle Paul wrote the book, Open Communities for Dummies. It's about one paragraph long, and it's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 19 through 23. I want to read this in the message. It says this: even though I am free of the demands and expectations of everyone, I have voluntarily become a servant to any and all in order to reach a wide range of people, religious, non-religious, meticulous moralists, loose living immoralists, the defeated, the demoralized, whoever. I didn't take on their way of life. I kept my bearings in Christ. But I entered their world and tried to experience things from their point of view. I've become just about every sort of servant there is in my attempts to lead those I meet into a God-saved life. I did all of this because of the message. I didn't want to just talk about it. I wanted to be in on it. See, Paul didn't see people reaching people as with the gospel as a thing to do, but as a way to live all day and every day. I was reading about the life of Francis de Assisi. Francis invited a young monk to join him on a trip to preach in town, and honored to be given the invitation, the monk readily accepted, and all day long, he and Francis walked through the streets and byways and alleys and even into the suburbs, and they rubbed shoulders with hundreds of people. At the day's end, the two headed back home. Not even once had Francis addressed the crowd, nor had he talked to anyone about the gospel, and greatly disappointed, his young companion said, "I thought we were going into town to preach." Francis responded, "My son, we have preached. We were preaching while we were walking. We were seen by many, and our behavior was closely watched. It is of no use to walk anywhere to preach unless we preach everywhere as we walk." See, Paul lived with the intention of constantly adapting himself to the culture he was in and the individuals he encountered. This isn't being phony, or trying to imitate everyone. It's intentionally taking an interest in who people are and what motivates them, finding out what they value. Instead of waiting for people to come into our building and accept Christ and then accept our subculture before we truly invest ourselves in them, what if we took our relational gifts and went to them? What if we pastored and discipled people that are not even Christians yet and have never darkened the door of our church? See, this is exactly what Paul is talking about. Each and every one of us can be a community builder because communities are made up of individuals. Every individual has an influence and effect on the tone of the community that they're a part of to make it either more open or more closed. Here's Paul, one man. He made a drastic impact on the first century church by being a very open community type of guy. And if I am an open community individual, I can affect my church community. If you are an open community type of person, you will have that effect in your church community. And I believe that we can truly be the community of the King. See, God's community needs to reflect who He is. And we must be careful that we're actually representing His community and not just assigning His name to the things that we're doing. See, the Pharisees and the disciples were guilty of creating closed community. And Paul wrote the book on open communities and missional living. And he swung the door of salvation open wide to all of those around him. And we as individuals can influence the community of the King. I want to take just a minute. I want to pray before we close this down for tonight. And I want to ask you tonight, maybe you're watching this and you don't know Christ. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And when I accepted Christ, no one showed up at my door and started, you know, going through my record collection and tearing my posters off the wall or telling me how to cut my hair or dress. They just said, "Joe, get to know Jesus." And as I did that, God began to change who I was. He began to change my life. And tonight, or if you're willing, if you're open to that, if you'll just simply say, "God, I believe in you. I believe you died for me. I want to follow you. I believe you rose from the dead so that I can live in my soul." God will do a miracle in you tonight, and you can begin to live and know Him. You can get to know Him for yourself. Lord Jesus, I just pray for any who are watching this, Lord, and as they open their heart to you, God, I pray, Lord, that you would make yourself real to them. Lord, we confess that we are sinners. We ask, Lord, that you would forgive us. We ask that you would come and live in our lives. And just as you rose from the dead, God, raise us up into new life, God. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. For us who are believers, the future of our church depends on our willingness to be open, to be an open community. And, you know, soon we're going to be coming back into the church and we're going to be seeing our old friends and we're going to throw our arms around each other. Maybe, well, maybe not, but we'll high five from a distance or whatever we're going to do. But we need to be an open community. We need to be those who have this open heart towards the people that are around us. I want to challenge you to begin to disciple the lost. I want you to lead them one step closer to Jesus. Even if they haven't prayed and gotten saved yet, lead them one step closer. You're discipling people who have not even come to Jesus yet. And I believe the Lord will be honored and the church will be blessed. Amen. Thank you so much for your time. Lord bless you tonight.